for the certificate of God's house. One more time, this is again our leadership conference for 2018. We've got the right equipment in place, got all we need to praise him. Got our voices, got our testimonies. We've come to give him praise. And we certainly thank God for our bishop and our state mother, all the officials of our state. They're getting the registration ready, so we'll let you know when that's available for you. And you might be able to purchase that. We ask that Mother Maple, Miller will come and with her singing.
Amen.
Lord, and with her.
This day.
today. They're gone. Don't worry about tomorrow. It's not here yet. Let's just enjoy the present. Let's enjoy the Lord today. Certainly thank God for you for moving a little ahead of schedule this morning. Thank you for being here early. It takes some gathering together the first day, but we thank God that we're here. And we're going to go ahead and move into our Christian education phase. Send you the first. We'll break them at the end of our workshops today. I certainly appreciate the Dean of Education, Director of Christian Education, Dr. Moses Harris. He's going to come and he'll have this block of time to give us instruction, different presenters, and we certainly thank Dr. Now let's receive him with an applause this morning.
Missionary Melanie Brown. And she's going to talk to us about personal relations
and evangelistic outreach. Two people whom I highly love and respect, I thank God for them. And I would say this, that Pastor Ivan Johnson, new pastor, but let me just read a couple of things that will be in his hands. Pastor Ivan is well known throughout the kingdom of God as a servant at heart, one who is an intercessor to the nations, prophetically preaches with power and clarity. He's an ordained elder in the Church of God in Christ, and he serves, of course, in our jurisdictional minister of music, does a lot of things in special assistant, office of Judith Christy McAllister, Church of God in Christ International Minister of Music. He's an author, amen, book, service, journal, encouraging, devotion, exhortation, and he's a pastor, he loves the Lord. So this time, let's say amen and give a round of applause for Pastor C. Ivan Johnson.
God bless you, Dr. Harris. Can we praise the Lord for our Dean of Education, Dr. Moses Harris, who does a wonderful job in advising these wonderful symposiums and sessions of education. We do give honor and respect, of course, to our wonderful bishop, to all of the superintendents that are present, to our beautiful First Lady that is coming in, and to all of you people of the Most High God. My task and my responsibility, and I'm going to stay and give you quite a few minutes back as well, since we are running on time. My assignment today with Dr. Harris has given me to talk specifically as pertains to how music impacts worship and church growth. Now, before I go any further, I do want to put this disclaimer out there that I do realize I've only been pastoring for a year and 6 months, and so I do not stand as an authority on church growth. Amen. But I do believe that there are some things that I will speak that will be able to at least help and enhance with my recent experience. I'm going to praise God, of course. I never like to stand and not acknowledge our musicians. We thank God for Brother Starris and Pastor Winston, who just filled it on the drums. God bless you, man. God will enjoy you immensely on Sunday. Now, how many of you understand that there is power in music?
Amen.
There is power in music, but one of the things that I have come to grow as I've toured in ministry is that you can have church without music. But you can't have church without praise.
Amen.
I'm saying it again. You can have church without music.
Amen.
But you cannot have church without praise.
Yes.
Now, as we read throughout the scripture, we understand that everything by which we as the people of God do should be rooted and grounded in the scriptures. We should be able to go back and search out the scriptures for further clarity and for further understanding. And, of course, to understand the origin by which the things we do, why we do, and how we do, and so on and so forth. And so we understand that whenever we read throughout the time of the scripture, going back to the Old Testament times, many times when we talk about praise and worship and music, the first person that we always ascribe this to is King David. Amen? We realize that David was a praiser, David was a worshiper, he was a songwriter, he was a poet, he was an author, he was a prophet, so many wonderful things. But we have to go back even further to the days of Moses so that we can really get a foundation of how praise was birthed and how music became a part of our worship experiences. Now, the Bible gives us an account, and I talked to a few Bible scholars and did some studying, and so the question was, when was the first song sang in the Bible? Now, some of the men said that, well, I believe the first song was sang when the Lord created Eve. Adam sang a love song because he was happy. He had a woman. And so some say Adam sang the first song. That he was so excited that he was the first love songwriter ever in history.
All right.
Because God gave him a helpmeet. But I got to take you to the scripture. If we go to Exodus chapter 12, we understand that for years and years and years, the children have been wandering in the wilderness. But there came a time when Moses knew that it was time for Pharaoh to let the people go.
Yeah.
And the Bible declares that as they begin to travel and as they begin to traverse and journey, that Moses saw this Red Sea before himself and the children of Israel. Now, I don't know about you, but whenever you see a large body of water, your first thought is, how am I going to get to the other side of this? But because God made a promise to Moses that I'm going to bring you and the children of Israel into a wealthy place. I'm going to take you to a land that is flowing with milk and honey. And so you cannot be intimidated by what you see. You cannot be intimidated by even what you know, because we've got to walk by faith and not by sight. And so Moses had the courage and he led the children and they got to the Red Sea. And so the question is, how are we going to get over this Red Sea? The Lord clearly instructed Moses to use what's in your hand. He lifted up that rod, and the Bible declares that when he lifted up the rod, that the Red Seas were parted. In other words, God made a way out of no way. He turned wet land into dry land, and they walked across, they traversed across this impossible Red Sea. And the Bible says that when they crossed over the Red Sea, that Moses and his sister Miriam. See, we are a Pentecostal church, amen? Yeah. We love tambourines, don't we? The Bible says that Moses and his sister Miriam, when they crossed over the Red Sea, that Moses began to sing a song. This was a song of triumph. This was a song of victory. Now as Moses began to sing, the Bible says that Miriam took out a tambourine. How many of you remember those services where it was just a song leader and a tambourine? Musicians couldn't make it. Drummers couldn't make it. Saints were running late. But all you had was a song leader and a tambourine. As the Bible says, I want to read this to you. Then sang Moses, Exodus, chapter 15, verses 1 through 12. Then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord, and spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider hath thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will prepare him an habitation. My father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name. Come on, this is Moses' song. Pharaoh's chariots and his host have he cast into the Red Sea. His chosen captains are also drowned in the sea. The depths have covered them. They sank into the bottom as a stone. Thy right hand, O Lord, is become glorious in power. Thy right hand, O Lord, hath dashed into pieces the enemy. And in the greatness of thy excellence, thou hast overthrown them that rose up against thee. Then thou sentest forth my wrath, which consumed to thee, O Lord, among the gods. Who is like thee, glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders? Thou stretched out thy hand, and the earth swallowed them. So what does this song tell us? How does this song give us instruction as to how we are to sing before the Lord? Understand something, that we will never be able to attain and experience the glory of God until we first give him the glory that is due to him. And if we are not careful, we will sing songs that are narcissistic. We will sing songs that are self-centered and only focus on us and what we want, but never focus on the Lord. The Bible says that as Moses and Miriam began to sing, every stanza of that song was as a worship unto God. Songs are birthed forth through testimonies. Right. You can't sing what you have not experienced. Amen. This song that Moses is singing, that Miriam is playing the tambourine to, it is birthed out from her place, birthed out from his place of testimony. Yeah. where God has brought them from. Okay, moving further, going over to 2 Chronicles chapter 5, and I believe that 1 and 2 Chronicles are awesome books, awesome guidelines. It gives us insight of the tabernacle and how the temple, Solomon's temple, was built and constructed, and all of the specific instructions that God had given unto Solomon to build this temple. Now understand that this temple was different than the tabernacle of Moses, because the tabernacle of Moses did not include any kind of song or music. The tabernacle of Moses was about sacrifice and repentance. And then you would be able to go behind the veil and experience the presence of God and take your petitions further. But there is no record of singing in the tabernacle. And so now here Solomon builds this temple with all the specific instructions that the Lord has given him. Don't have the time to go through, but the Lord told him what kind of wood to use. The Lord told him what kind of gold to use. The Lord told him where to put the cherubims and the seraphims. He gave him specific instructions because he says, listen, when you build this temple, this is a house that will bear my name. Amen. This is a temple that will be dedicated to my honor and to my glory. And so everything that happens in this place, I have an expectation that it is centered around me. Come on, somebody. I said his tabernacle. His expectation of us as the people of God is that he is the central focus. Well, how is he the central focus when we're always giving honor to man? Well, the Bible tells us to give honor to whom honor is due. And we give honor to the men, and we give honor to the women of God. Women of God, men of God, we honor the God that is in them.
Which were singers.
hearing me? They were also sanctified. Levites weren't just singers, but they were musicians and saints of God. I'm trying to tell you, here in Washington State, Pastor Winston knows this, we are at a deficit for musicians. You can't find them anywhere. Unless you pay $2,000, they're not interested in playing for you. And so I found myself in a position to where I had a musician that was playing for me. I'm telling myself, amen. I had a musician that was playing for me, and I knew that I smelled weed on him. And after a few services, I said, you know, Lord, I know you move, but I believe there is more. And I said, God, what is it? What is hindering your move? And then he showed me in the Word of God. He said, listen, it is not just your responsibility as the pastor to be sanctified, but it is also the responsibility of the Levite and the musicians and everyone that is a part of the service. So I had to repent and say, Lord, forgive me. For getting caught up in wanting music so bad that I got desperate. I'm not the only one, y'all. That's all right. I'm not the only one. I got desperate and let this weed smell of God. We said, no, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. And the musician's playing, no, 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 with his life. I wish I had time to really talk about them. But their sons and their brethren being arrayed in white linen. Uh-huh. I'm getting to my point, saints of God. We're talking about all these things that impact worship. Yes. They were given specific uniforms to wear. Uh-huh. So you cannot just be a Levite and wear whatever you want to wear. Everything's down. Everything's down. Now, brothers, everything is loose. Everything's loose. Come on, Holy Ghost. Come on, somebody. Yes. Amen. Not only were they expected to live a sanctified life, but they were expected to dress sanctified.
Amen.
They were always ready for the service of the Lord. How can you tell they were ready? Because they were dressed for the occasion. And so what that tells me is that when you come to church, you're not looking at my clothes, looking at my heart. No, when you come to church, not dressed for the occasion, that lets me know that you're not ready for service. And on white linen, and cymbals, and psalteries and harps. And they stood at the east gate of the altar. And with them 120 priests sounding with trumpets. Now listen, the priests and the Levites participated in praise. Uh-huh. Somebody say the priest and the Levites.
And the Levites
participated in the praise. I learned that I wasn't going to stop praising God when I became a pastor, just because I'm a pastor. And my bishop has demonstrated to me that you can praise and be a bishop and still be a bishop. So when the praises are going forth, I'm not sitting up in a chair like I'm a king. I'm like bishop. You know, he needs to jump a little longer. He can jump down a little bit more. But I'm like bishop. I come in with a bounce. Because praise is not just for the singers and musicians, but it's for the priests as well. It's for the leaders as well. So the Bible says, and we're talking about, amen, impacting our worship services. These are things that impact our worship services. When we're not dressed appropriately, it's a distraction. It impacts our worship services. When only one side is praising God and everybody else is sitting down, it's a distraction. It impacts our worship services. Said they, and it came to pass that the singers were as one. Somebody say as one.
Yes.
To make one sound to be heard in praising and begging the Lord. And when they lifted up their voice with trumpets and cymbals and instruments of music and praised the Lord, saying, "For he is good, for his mercy endureth forever." Then the house was filled with a cloud.
Yes.
Even the house of the Lord.
Yes, sir.
So that the priest could not even stand to move on with the program. When is the last time the glory of the Lord came and invaded your service in such a way where you could not even get up to move on with your little third Sunday program? When is the last time you allowed the glory of the Lord to come in and turn our house upside down and decide, you know what? Tradition says do this. Religiosity says do this. But the glory of the Lord says do this. When we are singing, when we are praising, when we are worshiping, when we are arrayed in the proper attire, and when everybody is on one accord, he says, listen, then I will release a Shekinah glory.
Yes.
This is a tangible glory.
Yes.
It's called the Kabbalah of God. It means the weight of his glory. This is when he comes and weighs down on us.
Yes.
When we have created where all the seats taken by ego, pride, and to keep dignity. Does the Lord have a seat to come in your house and just sit and dwell? Because see, when he sits and dwells, he points healing over there, revival over there, breakthrough over there, deliverance over there. Because the glory of the Lord had filled the house. So this is how music, amen, when properly executed in this context, impacts worship. It releases the glory, the manifested presence of the Most High God. Now, saints of God, we are in a dispensation of time where people want something for nothing. They want the glory, but don't want to give a sacrifice. They want their moms and their dads and their sons and daughters saved, but won't praise God. They want you to pray, and you to be on your face, and you to fast, and pastor, I'm just down, and pastor, do this, and pastor, please, 2 o'clock in the morning. Oh my God. Amen. You can't pray for yourself. You can't. Else to do it for us. But nobody can invoke the presence of the Lord like you can.
Amen.
And when we all take our personal responsibility and do it together as one corporate body, then the Lord begins to move. The Lord woke me up last week and he gave me a word to share. 5 a.m. is my daily prayer time, and I also participate on a prayer call with our International Music Department. And he gave me a word to share with the people of God. I'm going to share it in this house today. And he said, I can tell my people, talking to a host of musicians and singers and songwriters and renowned individuals, he said, tell my people to put my name back where it belongs.
Right. Right, sir.
Mm-hmm.
That's good. Amen.
Tell my people to put my name back where it belongs.
That's right.
Put my name back in music.
That's right.
That's what he said.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He said, put my name back in your sermons.
Right.
Come on, somebody.
Yeah. Yeah.
He said, put my name back where it belongs, because there is no other name under the heavens by which man can be saved.
Say that. Say that.
Demons are settled.
Yeah.
Demons are comfortable because they don't hear the name of Jesus.
here in life. Demons are residing. Demons are dwelling.
Yes.
Because they don't hear the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And so he said, tell my people, because when we look at this, going over to chapter 6, I'm not going to go through it, but chapter 6 of Chronicles, the Bible further goes on to say that then said Solomon, that the Lord has said that he would dwell thick in the darkness. Okay, verse 2. He said, but I have built a house of habitation for thee, and a place for thy dwelling evermore. Then he goes on to say that now it was in the heart of David, my father, to build a house for the name of the Lord, of God, of Israel. And so it was in the heart of David. Solomon took on this responsibility to carry on this vision, to build a house that would encapsulate, that would worship, and that would exalt the name of the Lord. Now, Yahweh, and in certain places, even until now when I went to Israel, they would not even say that name out loud. They won't even put it on paper, because they feel like that name is so sacred. That name is to be reverenced in such a way, it should not just be thrown any and everywhere. That name is only reserved for the house of God.
All right.
But we thank God that now that we are under the new covenant, hallelujah, yeah, now that we've stepped out of the Old Testament, songs. There are many different types of songs. I want to talk about how music impacts church growth. There are many types of songs. We see how music impacts our worship experience. Now, there are many types of songs, and one of the things that is so imperative for us, and as I've given my disclaimer in the beginning, I don't stand here to be an expert on church growth, but I believe, saints of God, that if we really want to see our churches grow again, we must consider a new approach. Amen. Now, our new approach does not change the Word of God.
Amen.
Guess what? Our new approach doesn't even mean that we have to rid all of the songs of Zion. Amen. But a new approach moves us into a place where we consider multi-generational worship experiences. And one of the biggest problems that is plaguing the body of Christ is that we have found ourselves and been guilty of focusing on one generation more than the other. And so now you have the millennials saying, well, I don't want to be around no old baby boomers. They don't know nothing. And so they gather in one place. But then the baby boomers over here, y'all don't know nothing. See, you don't want to be taught nothing. Can't nobody tell you nothing. So there's this constant battle. So what happens with this constant battle is the millennials tell their baby boomer parents, I'm going to a different church. So you got the parents worshiping at one church, millennials worshiping at a different church, and now the house is divided. The families are divided because we are lacking in a multi-generational approach in our worship experience. Now, what does a multi-generational approach? One of the things that I love about Bishop Brown, and I have incorporated this in my church, and when I talk about him, this is not flattery. When I go across the country and do workshops, I herald his name because he taught us something at Trubine.
All right.
One of the things that he taught us, I was on the third Sunday praise team. Now that's the, that's the jumping praise team. That's the rally praise team. And one time Bishop had to tell us, he said, listen, you can't just sing only just all new songs. You got to learn how to mix some of the old and the new together.
Amen.
To engage everybody.
Yes.
So that nobody is left out of the worship experience.
Amen.
So you look at Trubine and you see baby boomers,
Is there ever conflict when we go? Absolutely. Is there ever disagreement? Absolutely. But I promise you, you will be happy that you settle a conflict. You'll be happy that you sat and take time to settle disagreements opposed to your church being divided because young people don't like their part. So if we would take time, what does multi-generational worship look like? We're not just talking about its song, but also considering more laity involvement. Amen. We don't always have to wait until Youth Sunday to let our young people read the scripture.
Amen.
We don't have to wait until a certain Sunday to let a woman. Let me say, every Sunday is Women's Sunday in most churches because women outnumber the men anyway. And you will find that when one young person is excited about being a part of the ministry, then they will go and tell other young people. They will put it all over Facebook.
Amen.
If your church, if nobody in your church is on Facebook Live in your service, you gotta figure out what's going on. If you don't have a young person that is excited, well, like Sister Cleo, she's not young, amen, but she always has her phone out because there's always something going on. Amen. If you don't have someone in your ministry that is trying to Facebook Live your services, you need to check your approach. Because when they are excited, our youth, our young adults and millennials are excited, and other generations are excited about being a part of a worship experience, they will go and tell other people.
Amen.
You will find church growth. So as we consider the different types of songs, amen, and for ministers of music, the music impacts the worship. But you have to be willing, and you have to be willing and available, let me say it that way, that when you feel a shift in the Holy Ghost,
yes,
to shift with what the Spirit is saying.
Amen.
You may have practiced all Tasha Collins.
All right.
You may have practiced John P. Key.
All right.
But the Lord may say, go back and just say, yes, Lord.
Yes.
Or go and grab a hymn and sing Amazing Grace.
Yes.
And so what you got to do is make sure that your pride and your arrogance does not get in the way of God. And
yes,
making you think, well, I know what the service is. No, you don't know. God knows what the service is.
Yeah,
all
right. Amen.
Multi-generational approach. We got to teach my generation, younger generation, that we are not in control of the service.
Amen.
We've always got to have our ears open to hear what the Spirit is saying. And so before we sing songs, we must ask these questions. What is the song about? Is the song more about me, or is it about him? Does the song ever have any messages of repentance, or is it always about praise and blessing? Does the song ever bring me into a place of reflection and a place of moving into subjection and obedience to the Holy Spirit? Or is it always talking about my freedom and my liberty and all that? What is the message in the song? And I encourage, amen, pastors. I'm more intricately involved because I'm a music minister. But I encourage pastors every once in a while, ask your praise teams, what do you plan on singing this week? And why did you pick that song? It's a new song. It being a new song is not enough. Because a new song may not work for the spirit of the house. Amen. If your pastor is in a series of revival, then your songs should be geared toward the breath of God, the presence of God, the manifestation of God, the breakthrough of God.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
If your pastor is in a series about prayer, then your songs should be geared toward prayer. But it takes sanctified and spiritual Levites and worship leaders to be able to discern and hear what the Lord is speaking for that house.
Amen.
So what is this song about? What kind of energy does it carry? You all know it rains a lot in Washington. Some Sunday mornings it's not so sunny. Amen. So sometimes I'll tell the praise team, no gloomy songs today. All upbeat. So say, yeah, come on, stay straight there. Because you know the things already gonna come dragging in. Oh, it's raining. Oh, it's dark. Oh, my arthritis, my back. I just, oh Lord, it's just this cold weather.
Help
oh,
us.
I said, oh Lord. Amen. We're not singing lullabies today. We gotta lift the service up. Amen. Bring the energy up. What is my particular instrument doing? And what are the other instruments doing? And how do they relate to each other? I encourage so often that not only does the praise team and the choir need to rehearse with the musicians, but the musicians also need to rehearse with one another.
Amen.
So that they can become congruent and build a level of flow where they're not being a distraction. So that they too can just sit and have sessions of playing in the spirit. That God may download new melodies and new tunes so they're not playing licks and songs from the world. Now, some of us are a lot younger, Pastor Weston. But sometimes when musicians start playing stuff, and you start looking at different generations with their eyes all up like, I'm like, what is it? Well, that must have been a Rolly song. Uh-oh. So now the whole house is distracted. Now the old school saints are upset. I can't believe they are upset. Because you have brought the world into the church. So how do you think that impacts the worship experience? Not only do our musicians have to be careful not to play music and tunes from the world, that's why it's important to be careful of what you're listening to, because whatever you put inside of you is what's going to come out. But it's also important to be cognizant of your volume.
All right, say that. Amen.
Amen.
Instrumentation is an accompaniment to singing. What did I tell you in the beginning? You can have church without music, but you can't have church without praise. Worship. Number one, hymns.
Yes.
We cannot leave out the hymns of the church. And there is nothing more embarrassing than when a preacher gets up to sing a hymn. And I'm not just going to put it off on the musicians. But us as the singers don't know how to follow behind. Superintendent Vincent pulled one.
Go ahead and say it.
He pulled this hymn out. And you would have thought he was speaking Chinese to me, because I never heard that song in my entire life. Didn't know the lyrics, didn't know what to do. Amen. So I just looked him back down to the walk of shame, went back to my seat, like, I don't know how to help him. Amen. But we're responsible to study the songs of Zion. The hymns of the church have set the foundation. Listen, our music departments are standing on the hymns of the church. Hymns are timeless. Hymns, you can recompose them, same lyrics, but with a new composition, and it have just as much effect as it did 100 years ago.
Amen.
These are the songs that have stood the test of time. Many of them were written before our parents were born, but these tunes are typically composed with lyrical complexity needed to communicate deep theological truths. These hymns were written from the place of scripture. These songwriters went and they went through Psalm and they went throughout the books of the Bible. And they wrote these songs, okay? There are also congregational songs, all right? These are the type of songs where we sing together as a congregation. You might have a song leader, or it can be spontaneous, like back in the day, and someone just jump up and say, what do you know about Jesus? Then you move into the wrong response, he's all right. Amen. Those songs still work.
Yes.
Then you have your praise and worship music, which is more contemporary and it's more modern. But saints of God, I say all the time that if your praise and worship music has too many lyrics for the people of God to learn in one service, it's not a good song for the church.
Amen.
And unless you have screens like the Carters, amen, it's really not a good idea. Amen. Because people cannot engage in worship if they don't know what you're saying, or if they can't understand the words. So more wordy songs of praise and worship are not necessarily appropriate. All right. Lastly, there's choral music. Okay? This is music that specifically focuses on three-part harmonies, and there are choir songs that are not appropriate for the praise team.
Amen. Amen.
And you got to know the difference. Your minister of music has to know the difference. You're trying to, why is people not getting with it? Because it's not intended for praise and worship. There are some songs that must be communicated by a choir, because all the intricate parts bring all of the harmonies together. Amen. This is how worship impacts, this is how music impacts our worship experience and multi-generational ministry. I'm telling you, saints of God, it works and will help us grow the church. Do we have any questions at all?
Can you tap into us?
Yes. Well, praise God.
Amen.
Let's give a lot of hands for Pastor Gavin. Amen. If you have questions, would you jot it down? We're going to go to our 10-minute break. And so if you need to take care of some kind of needs, hold your question. We'll come back. We'll have our next presenter. And then we'll be able to continue in that vein.
Like this.
Amen. 10 minutes from now.
10:21.
Amen.
11:21.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. That's
it. Amen. Fresh start. Amen. Those of you who are going out, those of you who are staying in, thank God for the Pastor Johnson. Amen. Amen. Now, does anyone have a song?
Because what this kid didn't catch us.
Sing in Spanish? Can you play in Spanish? Soy soldado de mi señor Jehová. Soy soldado de mi señor. Soy soldado, soy soldado. Señor Jehová. Soy soldado, soy soldado. Señor. I'm a soldier, I'm a soldier. I'm a soldier, I'm a soldier. walk clothes on.
In the army of the Lord.
Got my walk clothes on.
In the army.
So I shall die, though. And he said, "Your name is Bob." So I shall die, though. So I shall die, though. Say, "Yo." So I shall die, though. So I shall die, though. Say, "Your name is Bob." So I shall die, though. So I shall die, though. Say, "Yo." Oh, and the cruise, and the cruise, go prepare to be like loose. He lost my chat, baby, I'm my yola, baby. Where I need poor faith, though me, I suit. He said, pray con el Dios, he started. Oh, and the cruise, go prepare to be like loose. He lost my chat, baby, I'm my yola.
Thank you.
wish they could have my life. I was young, but I recall singing songs was mother's joy. And as the shadows gathered at the
Just give the Lord a great big hand. bishop, and to our mother in her absence, and to all the men of God, to our bishop's wife, Dr. Brown, and just to all the women, men, everyone in the house of the Lord. Give yourselves a great big hand. But you know, things happen. There's an infirmity that has touched my body, and I'm using wisdom. I can do the same thing sitting down. Because I am a jumper, I'm a praiser, I'm a runner. But I want to be able to make it through the rest of the week. Amen.
Amen.
So my workshop this morning is personal relations and evangelism outreach. And the Holy Ghost put in my spirit, let's remobilize. How many military people do we have here? So I looked up and mobilized, and I said, that's deep. I said, I don't even know what it means. But I heard it in my spirit. And he said, to make something movable, usually it's a part of the military to assemble and gather our arms and get ready into readiness for active service. And when the Holy Ghost put that in my spirit, he said, it's time to remobilize.
Yeah.
Time to remobilize. Somebody just turn to your neighbor and say, time to remobilize.
Time to remobilize.
The objectives of this workshop, so I'm doing it in teaching mode. The objectives of this workshop are to, so you're going to see RE and RE. And my husband said, why would you do that? I think you should take it off. I said, but I want them to get it. Re-inspire. So when I looked up the word re, it said again and again and again. Again, again, and again. And sometimes we think it happens one time, but we have to re-inspire ourselves over and over and over again. The saints of God, one thing that I say when I'm ministering, say we go through like a roller coaster. We're up and then we're down. We're up and then we're down. And that is a normal part of life. Saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost. But we go through issues. We go through things where sometimes we're uninspired. But the Holy Ghost ignites us and re-inspires us.
Amen.
Revive. We need to be revived. We need to be activated, set into motion to gain a newness in evangelism.
Amen.
Renew.
Yes.
Retrain. Yes. Constantly. It doesn't matter how old you are, how long you've been in the way, how long you've been sanctified, saved, we need to be retrained.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's why we have the leadership conference. That's what we're doing, to be retrained. Re-equipped. We got to be re-equipped with the word of God, the knowledge of God, through fasting and prayer. Reinvigorated.
Yeah.
We need to be re-excited again.
Yeah.
We need to be re-excited again.
Yeah.
Re-released for service. How many are ready to be re-inspired, revived, renewed, retrained, re-equipped, reinvigorated, and released for service?
Yes, yes.
How many are really ready to be released for service to reach this dying generation?
Yes.
We also want to mobilize our strategies of effective evangelism that reaches the heart, the mind, the body, and the soul. And this might not be grammatically correct, but one person at a time.
Yeah.
Now, I'm going to be like Pastor Ivan. I'm not an itinerant evangelist in this season. I've been going around to the churches and local, but I'm not wanting to get on the planes and fly. That's not my season right now. My assignment is to reach individuals and inspire individuals to go out and compel souls to come to Christ. My assignment right now is this very moment is going to the homeless shelters. That's where the Lord is placing me. And the shelters with the women and the children. And I tell you, I get excited when I go there. I mean, it's just like, I've never been in a homeless shelter, but I know, like we were taught, pain's pain, hurt is hurt. I might not have been in that situation, but I needed a place to stay.
Amen.
Amen. And so they need someone to evangelize. So that's what my assignment is. So I'm going to give it to you like the Lord gave it to me. So be patient with me because I'm going to read it. There must be a remobilization of the Great Commission. It is not just for the disciples. Somebody say that. It's not just for the disciples.
Not just for the disciples.
But also mandated for us today. Not just the evangelists, but those that have been baptized in the blood of the Lamb.
Yes.
Bought with a price. Born again believers. How many born again believers do we have in this room? Yes. In Matthew 28:19-20. Jesus said, go ye therefore make disciples for all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit,
yes,
teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age.
Yes.
Therefore, we must understand that the Great Commission is a commandment of action. To go, therefore, we must have the power and the anointing of the Holy Ghost. We can't do this on our own, in our own flesh. I am a motivator by nature. I was a cheerleader. So I can get you excited and pump you up, but how long is it going to last? What manifestation is going to come out of it? Because you hear me now, excited. But what manifestation is going to come out of it if the anointing is not attached to what I'm doing?
Amen.
However, we must be trained so that we can be effective and excellent at what we do. Evangelist is often referred to as work only for the pastor, the licensed preachers, and missionaries. Most of us, when approached to go out and evangelize, the response is, I'm not an evangelist, or that's not my call. Evangelism is not about being called, but it's about being commissioned. Somebody say commissioned.
Commission.
Which means to appoint or assign to a task or a function. When you accepted the Lord Jesus into your life, you automatically became a commissioned officer in the army of the Lord.
All right now.
We are servants and representatives of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And everything that we do must reflect this fact.
Yes.
So the Holy Ghost told me, sometimes you got to go back to the beginning. Yes. And I'm a person, I love to read, I love to research. And so a little history, you can read some of my bio. I grew up very, very Catholic. Very Catholic. Like very, like genuflected, you know. I wanted to be a nun, I put it like that. And then the Lord tipped in my, one grandmother was Catholic and one grandmother was Baptist. And I used to go to church all the time. So I was a little confused. But then when I grew up, I said I had a great heritage because I learned about discipline. And I learned about studying the Bible, you know, learn different things, you know, in this Christian walk. And then the Holy Ghost got a hold to me. And I had a Zuza experience here at the True Bar Community Church of God. And I remember one of the first things that I talked to my pastor about was, can you tell me about the Church of God of Christ? Because we didn't have all Google and everything like they have now. So he said he had a book and he began to talk to me. And, you know, and I began to be intrigued by Bishop Mason and the history. But the Holy Ghost brought me back, so I started reading about it this week. And the Lord said, let's go back to the manual. We got to go back to the basics. Because if we sit here, a lot of us think evangelism is what I do on Thursday evenings after Mother speaks with the mic and compel people to come to the altar. That's not evangelism. But that's what a lot of people think, that's what we do.
Yeah.
And so we got to go back to the manual. The constitutional mandate for evangelism in the official manual of the doctrines and discipline of the Church of God of Christ.
That's right.
That's what y'all told me, that's who I am.
Yeah.
Right. I'm Church of God of Christ.
Yeah.
Hand clapping, foot stomping, tongue talking. So my mother always told me, if you're in it, you're in it.
Yeah.
Now, disclaimer, I wasn't back there then, so I don't know all the precepts and guidance and whatever, but this is what I read. This is what's helped me to stay this far. Where I am sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost.
All right.
The Church of God in Christ is a Pentecostal church.
Yes.
We believe in the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Mm-hmm. The Holy Ghost empowers us to proclaim, evangelize the gospel to the ends of the earth.
Yes.
That's in Acts 1:8. This belief is so vital to our existence, the Church of God in Christ,
yes,
that it has actually been recorded in the constitution of our church. This expresses our commitment to evangelism.
All right.
So it was a mandate that was set in stone. We got to go back. We have to remobilize. We got to retrain. We got to relay. And the reason why I believe the Holy Ghost put this in my spirit, because we've gotten stagnant. We've gotten stagnant. Because it's about us, our church, our four walls. And I see it. Because especially when you go to the homeless shelters, I'm not a person, I haven't been out, you know, a lot of people go out to the streets, go to the hospitals, nursing homes. They have different areas. But we've gotten stagnant. And the evidence is, now this is from the Holy Ghost, because our churches are not filled.
Right.
Oh gosh. There's so many out there. Plenty, plenty. The harvest is plenty. So many out there, and we're doing the same thing. That's what the Holy Ghost, he put that in my spirit. And we were reading our mission statement at our church, and my husband got up. I can't remember the exact words. I remember Dr. Brown Mother had repeated, we got the part, we felt convicted. Because we weren't going out compelling those, influencing those, and talking to our neighbors. Neighbors, our people in the job. We'll talk to them. We'll encourage them. We'll pray for them. And one water, one plant. One plant, one water. God put it in you. But how many of those have we actually evangelized? Spent some time with them. Somebody evangelized me. Really, they did. That's why I'm here. Statement from the introduction of the official manual. The Church of God of Christ is one of the fastest growing denominations in the world.
Merci.
As our name suggests, we are a God-centered church rooted in Jesus Christ, which believes first in faith in God. This is why no problem or event or succession or events can defeat us and those whom God loves. It is this faith that we must communicate to others, which is the beginning of evangelism with the preaching of the gospel. And that's not just for the preacher, not just for the missionary. Touch yourself, say, that means me.
That means me.
That means me. Turn to your neighbor, say, that means you.
That means you.
Oh God, thank you, Jesus. You don't have to have a hoop.
No.
That's right.
Amen.
You don't have to have a hoop.
Amen.
My granddaughter says every time I talk, I'm like I'm preaching. She said, hey, you know, every time I talk. But I'm just excited because I'm especially if I'm talking about the Lord.
Amen.
But that doesn't mean that you have to do that.
Amen.
You might be a quiet person like Mother Allen. She evangelizes and ministers to me every 2 weeks in her soft, quiet, still voice.
All right.
She does. So that means that we've got to go out and do this work. It's vital. So what I did, I kind of broke down that commission. And I'm an interactive person, so I'm going to have somebody read number one. You got to read it like the Church of God in Christ. On the page that says, that has the Roman numerals, somebody read that for me.
Go. This is the most important, because it requires the believer to take the gospel or good news into the highway and heavens.
Okay, I need you to say go again.
Go!
One more time.
Go!
All right. It's time to go.
Go, man.
It's time to go.
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 That's right. Who are you assigned to when you're going? That's the first question First question. How many people sitting in here, raise your hand if you're a person that goes out and does outreach, any type of evangelism in the streets? What is your assignment? Can you share that?
We go to the homeless shelter in Tacoma every Tuesday and Friday.
Anybody else want to share?
What I do, I go by the store and get some goodies and drive by these homeless people. And they come to our vehicle and give me a chance to testify. And then also try to impact their mind as to love and they can do a whole lot more better when they do it with God and when they go on the street. And then I try to lead them to, because you know, just one thing, they got the ground. You know, give them somewhere. So I brought my right to die all the time. So I told them it was all the time.
Amen. Anyone else? I know there's a couple. I know Missionary Carter. I'm gonna call you out.
I get it now.
So we're opening the dialogue for personal evangelism.
Yeah.
in this workshop to where we can get ideas from each other to start evangelizing. Yes, we are the fastest growing church across the world, but then what happens, I'm learning this retention. They come and they go, and they come and they go, and they come and they go. And I like what Pastor Ivan said about the multi-generational, and I'm going to add evangelism to that. They come and they go, and they come and they go. We don't have to change the foundation of evangelism for the church, but sometimes you have to change the curtains, the paint, the carpet, the pews, but you don't change the foundation of holiness.
Amen.
And so a lot of the younger generation and some of the baby boomers and whatever, they're getting restless because there's not a lot of interaction among the saints.
Amen.
If I can say that truthfully and honestly.
Yeah.
How many visitors have come after the evangelism or the outreach team has brought them in to retain them? The pastors, superintendents can't do it all.
Amen.
They're feeding us and teaching us and molding us and mentoring us so we can go out, because that's what our job is called to do.
That's right.
To go out and compel them to come in.
Amen.
And so now the leaders are tired because they're doing it. Bishop is one of the greatest evangelists that I know. Everywhere he goes, they look at him and they say, oh, you look like a very distinguished man. You dressed up. Where did you just come from? Church. True vine. That's evangelism.
Yes.
Personal evangelism. We got to get back to talking to people.
Amen.
Interacting
Amen.
With people.
Amen.
We have gotten afraid. Somebody, we were talking in the conversation about different people of ethnic backgrounds, the word the turbans and this and that. We've even gotten afraid because now we're stereotyping people. We're stereotyping people. We're not people that are not clean, don't smell good. There used to be a time when the alcoholics and the drug addicts were out, and there were so many people surrounding them. Come on, yes, Lord. Pray. You don't see that anymore. You don't see that anymore. Used to go to Wright Park in Tacoma. There would be all type of evangelists and preachers ministering to the people. I'm not trying to make you feel guilty or convicted. I'm telling you what the Holy Ghost put in my spirit. He put in my spirit. Go down. So what is your assignment? What is your gift that God has given you to go out and evangelize personally? What is it that he's giving me? My gift is doing hair. I like to make people feel good. So there's times when I'll go to the shelter. I've been to the prison. Had an opportunity in the contract to go to the prison. Now, I couldn't just talk Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. But if they bought it up, I'm sorry, warden. If they asked me what church did I go to, it opened the door. I was in a prison. And you know what was so awesome about it? I had scissors. I had sharp instruments, curling irons, but they knew that I was a woman of God. I think after the whole time I was there, I had one situation. One situation. Because they knew that I was there to evangelize. I was not afraid of them.
Amen.
Open the door. True Vine would go there and evangelize. Go to Purdy. What is your plan? Do you have a plan? We have to come up with a strategic plan. I learned that from the mission. I'm still learning that from the mission. Stick to the plan. You can't just go in and out haphazardly. If you're not a person that can take, how can I say this? If you cannot take seeing things that don't look like what you used to look at, don't go there.
Amen.
And don't try to be deep. Because that's not your assignment.
Amen.
One of the young ladies, we were talking in the class about evangelizing in the hospital. And I was teaching the class, Inspired Missionary One, that you've heard this. And I said, you can't go in the hospital. So I'm like, yes, Lord, thank you, Jesus. Oh, loud. And she said, that's why they threw me out. You got to be strategic. You got to be strategic. You can't stay there all day. You can't start a revival. Bible in the hospital. Now, if the Holy Ghost takes over, the Lord does what he does, that's a different thing. But when you're moving in your flesh, so you have to know your assignment and have a plan. And you got to know when to go. When to go. Personal evangelizing, remobilizing, coming up with a plan. You have to know who, what, when to go. When to go into the nursing home. When to go to the streets. When to go to the hospitals. When to go. You have to hear the voice of the Lord. And really, this is a Holy Ghost moment when you can sit down and lay before God with a sincere heart. Your evangelism might be with the youth. It might be with the youth on the basketball court, on the football court,
right,
in the gym.
Right.
It might be at the computers. Where? If I said I'm going to the shelters and our ministry, we collect clothes and jewelry and all types of different things. Well, we don't take those to, we have to research which shelters to go to. We just don't go to the places that we know that have all those things. We go to the ones that we know that don't have the clothes, that don't have the resources. So you have to be very strategic when you're coming up with your plan. Do we go by ourselves? It depends. No, our group, we don't go by ourselves. But you have to come up with who the Lord is going to team you up together in your church. And I'm not advertising for the Department of Evangelism, but how many evangelism, Department of Evangelism, do we have represented in this room? We have Home for a Mission. We have outreach groups. We do. But those are some things that the Holy Ghost has put in my spirit that we've got to go back to. And it might sound hard, but this is what he told. It comes to me first because I got stagnant. I was stagnant because we go through trials, we go through tribulations. We go through so many things in life. We think that we have to have a lot of money to go out and evangelize. I didn't have money when I first started. I went to my own closet. You have more that in here, you have more that in here, you have more that in here. Shoes. They need shoes. And when I say, I'm using me because this is what I know. I'm just trying to encourage you, revive you, revive you. They go crazy when they come into the room and see tables and shoes. You might not know what it feels like not to have
shoes. All right, now. I know. Amen.
Not to have a coat.
Amen.
Not to have deodorant. Not to have makeup. And everybody's circumstance is different. In the nursing homes, we used to go to the nursing home. There are some people sitting in the nursing home that never have anybody come to visit them. In the unit in the hospital where the preemie babies are, they said they're looking for people just to come and hold. But that's a gift of evangelism because now the nurses and the doctors and the workers are seeing your church, you as an individual, represented in that hospital, going and just holding the priest. So there's so many things that we can do to help strengthen and build the church through evangelism. Baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Break down that scripture. After we evangelize them, we gotta bring them in and teach them. We got to teach them who we are as the Church of God in Christ. That's what they did with ministry. Because there's so many different corrupt religious organizations and so many different witches and warlocks and groups and churches that are not teaching Jesus, Him crucified. After we get them in, after they've been evangelized, we got to bring them in and train them and teach them. Keep a hold to them. We must obey the voice of the Lord. He is beckoning us and calling us to continue the work that he told us to do in his word. We must continue this work. Can somebody read the scripture, Matthew 28 and 19?
Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost.
Go ahead and read the other two scriptures that you read.
Mark 16:15. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Luke 24:47-48. And that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And ye are witnesses of these things.
Amen. And in my summary, the clarion call is ringing loud and clear. There must be a resurgence or revival in our world. It's time to remobilize our strategies of effective evangelism that reaches the heart, the mind, the body, and the soul. We must recall our beginning, the foundation that Bishop Mason gave us, 1 Thessalonians 2:14, and recapture our foundation, the whole second chapter of the book of Acts. Before we outreach, I'm going to say this very slow so you can get it in your spirit. It's so serious, and I feel it. I feel it in my spirit. Before we outreach, we must inwardly reach back and reclaim our identity. The Holy Ghost fire must be reignited, rekindled in the body of Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Filled with the Holy Ghost. First of all, saved. sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost.
We have about one more individual, anyone? One more observation. Yes, ma'am.
We know that in the nation, we know as a people that in the nation of the United States of America, it is a push that is not God. And so, many people push you in the wrong direction. We push back. We pray. We pray and supplication will be known to God that He can intervene in the circumstances ahead of time, that the enemy may be defeated, that will come against us as a people, as a culture, and as a nation. And as we keep the word of God before us, in the midst of battle, a lot of time the battle is not all ours, it belongs to God. God uses man. And sometimes that man got to be still and know that he is God. And with the enemy raging in the midst of the region and in this nation today, it will take God to defeat our enemy. And our enemies are not each other. And God is greater than our enemy and our foe. And He raised and no weapon formed against me shall prosper. And that's for the body of Christ. And every tongue that I ask that rise against us shall be condemned.
Amen.
Church, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Our time has expired. We do thank God for you, Bishop, for allowing us this school of education. And we'll be back here tonight at 6:30. Invite a friend to come out tonight, and we'll be here again. The Lord said the same following day as we spend this week here at our annual leadership conference. At this time, we're in the hands of Dr. Dennis McCain. Say amen for him.
Amen.
Let's give our presenters a hand. Bless you today. It's time for official greetings from our prelay, Bishop Leo Charles Brown. I'm going to ask him to pray if he'd come, Senior Administrative Assistant, Executive Secretary, to visit our bishop.
Thank you, Dr. McCain. So happy to be here today in this first day of this leadership conference.
Amen.
So I was there reminiscing over past years. I used to call it the workers' meeting. You should call it the workers' meeting, where the workers come together, share, and get information that they can go out. It's always at the beginning of the year, praise the Lord. And then this melody got me talking, man, brought back memories when I used to preach on the street, praise the Lord.
Yeah.
You preach on the street on Sunday evening. After church, go to church, get out of church, and then we group would go out, preach on the street, we go down in Chinatown, yeah. Praise the Lord, and we'd have a crowd down there. This was years ago, praise the Lord, and but anyway, it's just something about the Church of God in Christ that has a edge on it, and the edge is the evangelistic attitude of the Church of God in Christ. We thank God for our leader,
amen.
Bishop Leo C. Brown.
Amen.
Praise the Lord, he's doing a great work, and
amen.
We're happy for him. Let's put that hand up there. God bless.
Bye.
And then sing the foundation song. Oh, there we are. Send the goodness here. All right.
God's been good to me.
Yeah. of a pain. Can the church give the Lord another hand of praise? Let's give the Lord another hand of praise. Shall rejoice and be glad in him. Amen. Praise God. Thank God for all of you that are here this morning. Much honor and respect to our leader, Bishop Brown. Amen. Senior Administrative Assistant Gray and all of the superintendents and all the pastors and elders and missionaries of First Lady of the jurisdiction, to my own wife, and to all of you that made the time. Amen. Praise God to be here for this first session, amen, of our leadership conference.
Yes.
Amen, praise God. And we're so glad to see you here. Hope that you're comfortable. Walk the buckets. Amen, praise the Lord. And pray that everything is well with you, amen.
Amen.
One of the things is we got a lot to thank God for because we're still on the top side of the earth. Morning service, but in the meantime, we're thanking God for another day. Amen. Praise, praise God. Another day. I don't know about you, but pain is just sure about it. I can mind my own business. And the pain you hear. Stood up, the pain was in my foot. I don't know where all this stuff coming from. I thank God to have a foot to have pain in. I got anybody here this morning. Amen. Just grateful for all that God has done and God is doing. Amen. Praise the Lord. So we're looking for a great week and it's already off to a great start. Praise the Lord. And so we're before you to receive an offering. Amen. And I never apologize for asking God's people to support the kingdom of God. Amen. You know what? You never find a club owner apologizing to his people that come support his club. Y'all ain't talking to me. Amen. Praise God. They tell me there's a cover charge to get in. And after you pay the cover charge to get in, you order a drink. And it's only $5 for a drink. Amen. Praise God. And then we come to church and folks say, the preacher just talk about money. All he talk about money. Well, it takes money to run the church. Amen. Dollars and cents to keep doors open, keep lights on, etc., etc. So I never apologize. The Bible lets us know that if we give, he'll bless us. Amen. He'll return it to us 30, 60, and 100-fold. Children, it is amazing about God. Amen. And how he takes care of us. So I'm going to ask you this morning if you would get a commendable offering in your hand. Praise the Lord. Ask all the pastors if you can, if you could give us a $20 offering this morning if you can to start off. If not, get the closest thing you can to a $20 offering, $19.99. Amen. Praise the Lord. And, but you give us, the Lord has blessed and prospered you. We'll be giving on this week. And for reminding all of the pastors, we're asking you for $150 seed offering. And all of the superintendents, we're giving a $200 seed offering for the expense of the meeting. Amen. And God is faithful. I bless Whitfield. He's given his 20. I got my 20. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise God. Preached us happy on Sunday night. Amen. Praise God. Did an excellent job in administering the word. Amen. Praise God. We're standing all over. The credit card machine is up in my office, but I don't have a mic to operate. Praise the Lord. Amen. We don't want to miss anybody. It's in there. The jurisdiction of the machine is in my office. It's in my office. It's in my office. Amen. Praise God. Pastor Clark. God bless you. Secretary Gray, $20.
We're going to pause at this time.
$20. Amen. Praise
God. And we're going to
God bless,
go to another location.
$20 this morning.
In the
Amen.
Jesus Christ. We're up here in the
Amen.
Media room.
The pastors and elders, $20.
Right now, and what I'm trying to
Amen.
Do
God,
is.
God bless Pastor Burris. Amen. $20. Amen.
Different.
Praise God. Bishop.
I'm going to have $25 this, and we'll be right back.
Amen.
And after the offering.
See these other pastors coming. Amen. Pastor Jones.